Introduce to you Humberto Fontova, who was born in Havana, Cuba in 1954 and fled Cuba at the age of 7 with his family to New Orleans, Louisiana. His father was a political prisoner of Fidel Castro and Che Guevara. Humberto has lived in New Orleans since 1961 and earned his bachelor's degree in political science from the University of New Orleans and his master's degree in Latin American studies from Tulane University. Humberto is the author of 5 publications as of today. The Hell Divers Rodeo was hailed by Publishers Weekly as highly entertaining, by Buclistas as a must-read. Bill Mayer made Fontova a regular on Politically Incorrect through the 2001-2002 seasons. Humberto's second book, The Hell Pig Hunt, is described by Publishers Weekly as fun, forceful, and compelling, and by Ted Nugent as just what the doctor ordered. Fontova's third book, Fidel, Hollywood's Favorite Tyrant, was a conservative book club main selection held by the Weekly Standard as a great service for liberty, justice, and truth, and by Bill O'Reilly as a great expose of Hollywood's pinheads. Fontova's fourth book, The Real Che Guevara and the Usual Idiots Who Idolize Him, was hailed by Investors Business Daily as finally the true story of one of history's most undeservedly mass murderers. Radio host Mark Levin says that he read it in 2 sittings and couldn't put it down. Fontova is a columnist for Newsmax, Human Events, Front Page Magazine, along with many outdoor publications, including Scuba Diver, Saltwater Sportsman, Bow Hunter, and Boating Magazine. Humberto has been featured on The O'Reilly Factor, Hannity and Combs, The Dennis Miller Show, Fox and Friends, among many others. He has been a featured speaker at David Horowitz's Restoration Weekend, at the Horowitz Freedom Center, the John Locke Foundation, Miami Book Festival, Palm Springs Book Festival, and Club Mensa's annual gathering, among many campus venues. His speech on the real Che Guevara at Washington University in St. Louis provoked a liberal furor. And to pronounce to you, Humberto Fontova is going to speak to you about Cuba. Here he is.
All right, thank you. Thank you, buddy. Thank you. This is a tremendous honor for me. Thanks for coming out. And first of all, I've got this up here, first of all, to show them off, the glories of capitalism, after all, huh? For you, $10 later on. The glory. But the point is that you're going to be hearing things up here from me. But the YF is inviting a complete nutcase to address us. What is going on? What are these people doing? Because the things you hear from me about the Cuban Revolution, which I consider the biggest scam that has ever been perpetrated by the socialist bloc against intelligent people, the biggest scam. The things you're going to hear from me, you say, doggone it, if I go back to class in September and I tell my professor this stuff, A, he's going to flunk me. 2, I'm going to probably get expelled from school because they contradict absolutely everything you have ever heard about the Cuban Revolution, about Che Guevara, about Fidel Castro, from your professors, from the History Channel, from NPR, from everybody. So I stress, everything you hear from me up here is thoroughly documented in these books, which have been published by the biggest, literally the biggest publishers in the world, Random House, Penguin, Regnery, and they have big legal departments, right? So when they get to that outrageous stuff, when they get my manuscript, geez, they go to the editor, where's this guy coming up with this stuff? You know, this isn't what the History Channel says. This isn't what I learned in college. What is going on here? Tell them to call me. And I had the lawyer, believe me. I spent many a conference call with the legal departments, with the world's biggest publishers. Follow my footnotes, baby. These are primary sources. I interviewed eyewitnesses to the Cuban Revolution. I was one, but I left Cuba when I was 7. Eyewitnesses, you follow, and guess what? I had to change nothing in my manuscript. I had to change the wording of some things, but everything, all of my claims about the crimes of the Cuban Revolution and the scams that they've perpetrated on just about everybody has held. So that's out of the way first. Keep in back of your mind, folks, that the regime represented mostly by this guy, and lived for a long time. Keep this in the back of your mind the whole time I'm talking here. Jailed and tortured political prisoners at a higher rate than did Stalin's regime during the Great Terror. Right there, it's crazy, how can that be? I ran the numbers, folks. Ann Applebaum, maybe you all have had her here, she's a great historian. She wrote the book, The Gulag, considered the definitive account about the Gulag, the Russian Gulag. And she said, at any one time, there were about 2 million subjects of the Soviet Empire in the Soviet Gulag. At any one time. Of course, the Soviet Union at that time was a nation or an empire of about 218 million. Cuba, at one time in the early 60s in Cuba, 61, 62, 63, one of every 17 Cubans was a political prisoner. My father was one of them. But we had a happy ending. But the point is, if you run the numbers, Cuba was a nation of 6.7 million people, 6.5 million people at that time. You run the numbers, I said a higher rate, a higher percentage of Cubans were jailed and tortured by the Castro regime than of Russians jailed and tortured by Stalin's. Obviously, they killed more. This regime murdered more political prisoners in its first 3 years in power than Hitler's regime murdered in its first six. Where's this guy coming up with this stuff? Follow the footnotes. Fully documented. I'm going to play a little word association game with y'all. I'm going to throw out some names of some famous political prisoners who suffered terribly in prison, and y'all can tell me if you know them. Eusebio Peñalver. Pat inviting this lunatic over here. I never heard of that guy. Ignacio Cuesta. Rolando Silva. Jesus. Ignacio Lopez. Who are these guys? Throw this one. Nelson Mandela. Oh, yeah, Jesus Christ. We all know who Nelson Mandela is. Yeah, that's that poor guy who was jailed. He's a black guy, and he was jailed in South Africa by that terrible regime. And he suffered horribly in prison over there. Everybody knows who that guy is. The first five names I've mentioned suffered longer in prison than did Nelson Mandela. They are also black. Three of them live in the United States today, a short cab ride from major media studios. They live in Miami. Some live in Union City, New Jersey. I had the honor of interviewing these heroes. They suffered longer than Mandela, 29 to 30 years in Castro and Che's torture chambers. And they suffered much more horribly in Cuba than Nelson Mandela. You can go to Google, by the way. Everything I'm telling you here, if you all doubt it, if you want to throw it in the face of your professors when you get back to class, they say, where are you getting this stuff at? Go to my website, hfontova.com. My email is on there. Give me the item you want me to document, and I'll shoot you back the documentation so you can go to your professor. Here it is. This is why Fontova says you're full of bull, prof. Okay? This offer stands. But all of those political prisoners suffered longer in prison and much more horribly than did Nelson Mandela. And you've never heard of them whatsoever. Why? That was my last book. The mainstream media and Fidel Castro, because you have been scammed by the mainstream media in conjunction with the Castro regime. Folks, the longest suffering political prisoners, black, white, female, and gay, in modern history, all suffered their tortures in Cuba. You would really, really, really think that a regime that specialized in torturing and murdering blacks, women, and gays would be in for a little bit of criticism from liberals. Folks, gays were herded into forced labor camps in Cuba for the crime of being suspected gays. This went on from 1964 to 1967. The prisons weren't called the Gulag, they were called the UMAP. Unidades Militares para la Ayuda de la Producción. There were forced labor camps. They're the same thing as Stalin's Gulag. And the sign, I interviewed victims of that system for my books. Eyewitnesses to that. And when they walked into the forced labor camp with barbed wire around them, machine gunners on the corners, same thing as in Germany, same thing as in Russia, but you never heard about them. When they walked into the camp, the sign in the front said, work will make men out of you. That's because many of the people being herded in were gays, suspected gays, mostly Cuban teenagers and kids in their early 20s. Being a rock and roll fan got you thrown into these camps. Folks, you know, because a lot of people go, well, you know, heck, the Rolling Stones just played in Cuba a few weeks ago, man. That's a cool place, Cuba. Folks, they're doing that now because tourism is now a top revenue source for the regime. And essentially, the Rolling Stones just did a free tourism commercial. Most of the people at that concert in Cuba were not Cubans. They were foreigners who came to Cuba, stayed at the hotels, and ate at the restaurants owned by the Castro family. That is why they were lying, that kind of stuff here. But in 1967, the Rolling Stones were playing in Poland, folks, in Warsaw. In other words, the Iron Curtain countries allowed rock bands. At the same time that the Rolling Stones were playing in Poland in 1967, concert, Polish kids rocking out to Satisfaction, Cuban kids who were trying to listen to Satisfaction, or You Really Got Me, or Day Tripper, clandestinely on the radio, because this was all considered Yankee imperialist rock music, hence subversive, were being herded into that camp. Work will make men out of you. If you wore tight blue jeans, if you tried to grow long hair, that was enough to be herded. If there were, sometimes these kids would hold concerts, would try to hold, you know, secret concerts at a park where they'd play rock music. The authorities, Che Guevara, was Minister of Cuba's Industry, would just surround the park. Imagine Lollapalooza, or Woodstock 2, one of these places, and all of a sudden, military trucks come in there, surround the place, and herd everybody there, the males primarily, into forced labor camps and cut their hair. Now, that's bad enough, but then imagine the people who played at Lollapalooza, Rage Against the Machine, or at Woodstock, Carlos Santana, wearing this guy on their t-shirt. You cannot make this stuff up, folks. You cannot possibly make it up. Think about it. Carlos Santana, during the 2005 Grammys, he played the sound score to the Motorcycle Diaries, and man, he showed up with the red carpet. Right, and he had a gigantic Che Guevara t-shirt on. Oh, man, and wow, I'm so cool, I'm so sharp, I'm so hip. Look who I'm wearing on my t-shirt. I am the sharpest guy. And the media was all agog. Oh, he's such a cool guy. He's so hip, he shows up. Carlos Santana, for those of us who knew, is proudly showing how hip and in tune he is by flaunting the emblem of a regime that made it a criminal offense to listen to Carlos Santana music. You have got to laugh, folks. That is why the nature of the scam is so, it's so monumental. Folks, in a sane world, we wouldn't be having this seminar. What works, socialism or capitalism? In a sane world, there's no point in that. Good thing it's an insane world because we can sit here and have fun. Now, most people will tell you, it's like saying, let's have a seminar and determine if they've found a cure for polio yet. Well, of course we know they have because they tested it in laboratories and they came up with the cure. And they tested in laboratory conditions, this cures. Well, a lot of people will tell you, socialism versus markets has already been tested in laboratories. Now, the closest to laboratory conditions, I think, would be, a lot of people would say, the Germanys and the Koreas, right? Here we had pretty close to control laboratory conditions. Two nations, same people, same ethnic group, both of them devastated by wars at the time. Half went commie, half went nominally capitalist. Which one worked, folks? Who had to build the walls to keep the people in? Who had to machine gun people who tried to escape? Obviously, people tried to escape from the commie side to the nominally capitalist side. This isn't rocket science. If you hold their feet to the fire, I've done this over the years, you can even get a liberal to admit that East Germany was a terrible place. Oh, well, gosh, Humberto, I mean, God, they had that wall. Did Reagan tear down this wall? People trying to jump over, getting machine gunned? That's awful. Everybody knows East Germany was the same place. 2 seconds later, they'll be telling me about the wonders of Cuban healthcare. And I don't know, well, Cuba, they overthrew a dictator, and they have free healthcare and stuff down there, and they throw out the mob that used to run it. Folks, I ran the numbers, again, documented. I ran the numbers. About 280 people were killed trying to escape over the Berlin Wall from East Germany to West Germany, about 280 people. And so liberals will admit, gosh, but that's a terrible place. Yeah, because that was publicized at the time. In the early 60s, you would see pictures of that. Think about that, 280 people. Again, fully documented, about 50,000 people have died trying to escape Cuba. 50,000 people, okay? So when you say we've got laboratories that have tested the efficacy of communism versus markets, and you point to Korea or East Germany, I'll tell you that there is a much starker market. There's a much more dramatic proof of the value of markets 90 miles from US shores, the Cuba. 50,000 Cubans died horribly. It's terrible to be machine gunned like people were crossing the Berlin Wall. That's awful. Cubans were both machine gunned. That's how it started in the early 60s. Castro's patrol boats would start machine gunning the people who tried to escape Cuba, free healthcare. People trying to escape free healthcare and free education. Imagine that. They would machine gun them. Well, the shots, and from helicopters, the shots started disturbing, obviously, the coastal residents of Cuba. I said, well, Jesus, what's going on here? So they started hovering over the rafters and the boaters in helicopters, and it would drop sandbags on them to sink them and let the sharks do the dirty work. Okay, that went on, and so forth. Why do I say 50,000? I ran the numbers. I interviewed for my books the people who used to run the Rafter Rescue Center in Key West, and the Coast Guard guys, and the guys who would fly planes to rescue the rafters. And I'm here to tell you that they would tell me, and they told me, all throughout the 60s, 70s, early 80s or so, the ratio was about 1 in 3. For every one Cuban that made it to these shores, 3 died. Horribly, typically, of exposure, of thirst, or were eaten alive by sharks. The guys who flew the planes said they would often be alerted to the presence of a raft or by the blood in the water flowing there. Folks, aren't we in Shark Week right now? The Discovery Channel? We're close to it. It's around now, Shark Week, right? Let a surfer get his pinky toe nipped by a shark in Australia, in Hawaii. Oh, man, the Discovery people are right there. Oh, that must have been awful. Oh, yeah, that shark bit my leg. This is, in other words, the Discovery Channel Shark Week stresses shark attacks. That's how they get ratings. Blood, gore. They call a shark attack the most horrible event in nature. Oh, this is horrible. Isn't it interesting that with 50,000 people, I contend, based on interviews that I conduct with people, that the shark attack capital of the world is not Australia, that is the Florida Straits. Every day, hundreds of people jump into flimsy little rafts. You can't even call them rafts. Or just inner tubes and start paddling to come over here. I interviewed many of these people who come over there who tell me, one guy told me, we were dying of thirst. We're dying of heat. So my father jumped overboard. We threw him a rope, and he had to dangle in the water. So he was there. A few minutes later, we heard his screams, and we turned around, and a flock of sharks were in a feeding frenzy around him, and they ate him. Wouldn't this make dramatic stuff for the Discovery Channel? They don't have to go to Australia and interview a surfer. They don't have to go to Hawaii. They can find this stuff right here in Miami. Why don't they? I started thinking about it. Isn't it interesting? They could find a lot more dramatic stuff. The Discovery Channel and National Geographic are business partners with the Castro regime. You're likely to see a lot of specials from Cuba. Just last year, they had Los Tiburones de Cuba. They did a shark special, Shark Week, specialized in Cuba. They didn't mention one shark attack. And I said, isn't that fascinating? I mean, they could really spice up the show with that stuff. They didn't mention one. And I started digging into it. A lot of the shows, the Discovery Channel promotes Buena Vista Fishing Club, tourism to Cuba. So you've got two items working against it. The business partner regime, first of all, even a liberal watching a show like that about Cuba would go, man, that's the most terrible event in the world, getting attacked by sharks. Yet for 56 years, thousands upon thousands of people have risked it annually to escape free health care. Now, why might that be? Maybe Cuba is not everything the media is telling us it is. Well, of course it isn't. So I am here to tell you, I have no proof, that that is probably why the shark capital attack capital world is never featured during Shark Week like Cuba by the Discovery Channel or National Geographic. It is absolutely astounding, folks. Remember that. 50,000 people dying horribly. But then a lot of people say, well, so what, Humberto? You Latin Americans are always trying to sneak out of your countries and sneak into U.S. Mexicans do it. What makes you Cubans so different? You know, why should do it? You know, that's why maybe East Germany is considered more dramatic. Or what's a big deal with you guys? Well, I'll tell you what the big deal is. And this is a laboratory that I'm telling you about. The best laboratory to show the failure of socialism and the values of markets is pre-Castro Cuba versus post-Castro Cuba. Don't compare Cuba to El Salvador and Mexico. It's different places. That's not a laboratory experiment. Compare prior to Castro, folks. Again, you're going to scoff. Your professor's going to scoff. Email me. I'll email you that documentation. Prior to Castro, Cuba took in capitalist Cuba, took in more immigrants on a per capita basis than did the United States, including the Ellis Island years, mostly from Europe. Prior to Castro, my parents and grandparents, any Cuban could get a U.S. visa for the asking. You didn't have to jump on a raft. Prior to Castro, any Cuban could get a U.S. visa for the asking and come to the United States. At that time, more Americans lived in Cuba than Cubans in the U.S. Oh, come on! Email me. I'll email you the documentation, and you can show it to your professor. It wasn't that dramatic. There were about 20,000 Cubans in the U.S. There were about 25,000 Americans. But the point is, at that time, when you were perfectly free to leave Cuba, Cubans say, this is pretty nice. Of course, that had to do with American tutelage. Cuba had only been an independent country since 1900. So the U.S. tutelage helped the markets arise in Cuba. My professor's going to go, but wait a minute. Cuba had a dictator before Castro. Humberto, what kind of bull are you trying to lay on us here? That a guy named Batista is a terrible dictatorship. That's why you guys had a revolution to begin with. Batista was not an ideal president. He was personally a corrupt guy and so forth. But the point is, all during the Batista regime, 52 to 59, Cuba experienced net immigration. In 1959, January 59, when Castro took over Cuba, the Cuban embassy in Rome, Italy, had a backlog of 12,000 Italians, that's the first world, folks, clamoring to immigrate to Batista's Cuba. You know, in a sane world, I could leave right now. I say, look, post-Castro Cuba, people were desperate to enter. Communist Cuba, people die, risk their lives daily to escape. Pat, I'll take my check, have your memory report. In a sane world, that would be all you need to know. People try to get into places that are market-oriented. And a lot of people say, well, how could you have a market, Humberto, in pre-Castro Cuba when you had a dictator, Batista? Well, what happens is that these so-called right-wing dictators, Batista in Cuba, Somoza in Nicaragua, Pinochet in Chile, Marcos in the Philippines. What happens is that these guys, you often have economic prosperity under these kind of guys because they're not really dictators. They want a cut of the action, a piece of the action. They want a kickback. Typically, their regimes are run, they want a kickback from all the main businessmen. And then they leave them alone. And what's the beauty of capitalism? You know, the beauty of it, you hear this better from the A-listers on that, Dr. Williams and all the rest of them you hear, but is that you don't really have to sit around with a brain trust figuring out how do we make capitalism work? How do we make markets? Let's hire a study. Let's put 50,000 egg-headed college professors to figure out how. No, all you've got to do is get out of the way of the businessman. Get out of his way. They'll do it. That's the beauty of the system, the invisible. And that's what these so-called right-wing dictators do in many cases. It was certainly the case. All they want is a cut of the action. Hey, you're building a new hotel. You open it. You want the contract to build a new road across Cuba? I need 7%. I need a cut of the action. In other words, a kickback, which is a tax by any other name. It's a tax. But the problem is, or the beauty of it is, that that tax amounts to less than does the tax from the busybody do-gooder eggheads when they come in. Okay, we need a tax on this. We need to regulate this. We need to do that. So when all of those prohibitions and regulations are put on top of a businessman in a do-gooder country, it comes out to a lot more interference than a corrupt dictator saying, give me 7%, you know? And then what does the dictator do? Gets out of their way. You guys do your stuff. And that is why I stress, in 1958, Cuba had a higher per capita income, Cubans, than Italians, than half of Europeans, double the per capita income of a Spaniard in 1950s. That's why Spaniards flocked into Cuba to move there prior to socialism. Folks, again, I stress, because this cannot be stressed enough, the longest suffering black political prisoners suffered in Cuba. You never heard of them. This week, this very week, a black Cuban ex-political prisoner, his name is Oscar Bisset, was on Capitol Hill. He was invited to the U.S. He's been in the U.S. for a week denouncing Obama's policy of opening to Cuba, documenting how it has worsened the condition of Cubans many times over, documenting this. On Capitol Hill, this gentleman, Oscar Bisset, suffered 11 years in Castro's torture chambers. Many of them were in a cell that was 4 feet high by 6 feet long, so that you can't stand up. I interviewed some of these black political prisoners. Eusebio Peña Aver passed away 5 years ago, but had the honor of interviewing for this book. What they did with him, the Castroite guards would taunt him, calling him, "Nigger, nigger, we pulled you down from the trees and cut off your tail. And this is how you reward us." This man suffered 29 years, longer than Mandela, in Castro's prison, 90 miles away. He lived in the United States for 10 years before his death, and you have never heard of him, and no media organ has ever mentioned this man. Think about that. Think about what that would do. Let's talk women political prisoners. 55,000 women and teenage girls were jailed and tortured by the Castro regime. Nothing remotely of that sort has ever happened in the Western Hemisphere. Many of these ladies live in the U.S. today, primarily in Miami, and I interviewed them. I said, "Why haven't y'all been on Oprah?" Right? I mean, what's the big theme on all of the women's chat shows, for lack of a better word? You know, how she got her groove back. Ho-ho! How she overcame adversity. Ha-da-da-da-da, getting her groove. Folks, you want to talk about getting your groove back? Try spending 18 years in a dungeon with roaches and rats crawling into them. They describe here in my book, the toilet was a hole in the floor, and the floor was crawling with rats and roaches. Sometimes these women would be enclosed for weeks at a time in utter, complete darkness so they couldn't see the roaches and the rats, but they could feel them, right? This is how the Castro regime that Andrea Mitchell, Barbara Walters, Soonover did with women. These women, many of them live in Miami today. And I said, "Well, y'all never got a call from Sally, Jesse, Raphael, and from Oprah, from any of these people?" They said, "The U.S. media has never shown the slightest interest in anything." But here's what would knock these women over. I mean, imagine going through these things for months and weeks. These women suffered 10, 15 years in prison, unheard of. Nothing like this has happened in the Western Hemisphere. What would really push them over the edge, you're undergoing these things, needless to say, no protection from the menstrual cycle or anything like that. So that's how they're living. But their prison was very close to La Cabaña prison, where Che Guevara's firing squads would be murdering hundreds of men and boys, some of them as young as 16, weekly. And so the women could hear from their cells, even in the darkness, they could hear the volley of the firing squads going off. Imagine, you're in the conditions that I just mentioned, and they would hear these volleys going off. So then a guard would come and rattle. They couldn't see, and they go, "You heard that? We just shot your husband. We just shot your son. We just shot your granddad. How you like that?" That's what knocked over many of them. Now, imagine these women finally escaping that, getting to the U.S. and living semi-normal lives. Wouldn't you say that that's getting your groove back? Completely ignored by the U.S. media. Completely ignored. Now that is getting your groove back. I know these ladies are a lot of fun to be around. I spend time with them and I interview them for my book. That is getting your groove back, but again, completely, completely ignored by the media. But enough about Cubans. Who cares, Humberto? All kinds of countries have human rights violations. I mean, Humberto, we trade with China, and you tell me we can't trade with Cuba? So finally, let me get to the point that Ron Robinson insisted that I talk about. Finally, I knew I was going to forget. Because you're seeing a lot about Cuba in the news now. The Kardashians went to Cuba. Conan O'Brien went to Cuba. Paris Hilton, Katy Perry, the Rolling Stones. Cuba is the coolest place in the world. To read the media, you would think, oh, well, it's just a normal place now. It's a cool, according to the Kardashians, it's the coolest place on earth. You had Karl Lagerfeld, you had a fashion show, you had the top fashion show in the world held in Havana last month. Wow, that's a cool place and so forth. So Cuba must be cool. And they're advertising tours to Cuba for students. Tourism is still technically legal, but last year, three times as many people visited Cuba from the U.S. as visited in the 1950s and it was still planned. So the embargo is essentially a joke. But here's the problem. Here's what you've got to take away. If you take nothing away, from our spiel today. Cuba now, for the last few years, has been experiencing record tourism. 3.4 million tourists visited Cuba last year. 500,000 of those from the U.S., though they didn't call themselves tourists. Many of them are Cuban-Americans visiting family there, but it doesn't matter, they still spend money. So 3.5, and by the way, during the 1950s, when, as we all saw in Godfather II in many places, Cuba was a tourist playground, man, it averaged 200,000 tourists a year. So hear what I'm saying. 200,000 in 57, it was 263,000. Last year, and for the last 10 years, 3.5 million have been visiting Cuba, mostly from Canada, the US is next, and then from Europe. Every dollar, loony, euro, peso that they spend in Cuba lands in the pocket of the regime. The Cuban regime, and mostly the Castro family, owns Cuba's tourism industry. So right now, Cuba is experiencing a 15-year record of repression. There have been more political arrests in Cuba in the last 2 years than there have in the last 15. And that is what Oscar B. said, the black political prisoner, was in the U.S. trying to explain to Capitol Hill and so forth, and that's why he was blacked out. Because what does it do? It contradicts the scam you're getting from the media that all the tourism to Cuba and all the foreign investment to Cuba is going to help the Cuban people. Here's a representative of the Cuban people. No, it's the opposite, folks. The regime owns it. Record tourism to Cuba, record investment in Cuba, foreign investment, record repression of the Cuban people. That's what you've got to remember, because in the media, you're going to hear tomorrow, right now, you're going to Google, oh, well, gosh, tourism experience, you know, everybody's going to Cuba, everything, it's open, the Rolling Stones are playing, it's just a cool place. The tourist infrastructure is owned by the Castro family. But Humberto, I keep reading about this embargo about Cuba. The cash flow, there's another thing for you to remember, to throw in your professor's face. The cash flow from the United States to Cuba, the annual cash flow, ever since Obama's been in office, actually a little bit before, it goes back 10 years, exceeds what used to be the cash flow from the Soviet Union to Cuba. Last year, $5.2 billion flowed from the U.S. to Cuba. The media calls that an embargo. Is that not a scam? $5.2 million, three times as many tourists as during the 1950s, and the media calls this an embargo. It is not an embargo, folks. It is not anything even close. What the embargo does, the sanctions that are in place now, they protect us. They protect us, the taxpayer. How many of y'all realize that for the last 10 years or so, the U.S. has been one of Cuba's top trading partners? Top trading partners and top food suppliers. What the embargo stipulates is that Castro pay for all of those agriculture products cash up front, baby. And that is why the U.S. taxpayer, as we're seeing in this campaign, everybody's saying, the U.S. taxpayer is being played for a sucker by the world, right? Isn't that a main theme? Everybody ducks on the teat of the U.S. taxpayer. We're played for suckers. There's one area where we can look around the world like this. Na, 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 na. Y'all got snookered. Every country that refuses to embargo Cuba, which is to say, sells them on credit, has been robbed blind by the Castro regime. We sell to Cuba, but they gotta pay us up front thanks to that embargo. What the farm lobby wants, the farm lobby wants the Export-Import Bank, the U.S. Export-Import Bank, that's our tax dollars, to finance those sales to Cuba so that when Castro stiffs them, as he has every other creditor in the world, you and I pick up the tab. But no, thanks to that embargo, we can look around the world. Y'all got snookered. We ain't, because of the Helms-Burton Act. If your professor says I'm crazy, email me, and I email you the documentation for what I'm talking about. The U.S. embargo of Cuba has saved the U.S. taxpayer a lot. Plus, it forced the Soviet Union to pump $50 billion into Cuba. That greatly helped bankrupt the Soviet Union. Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall. The Soviet Union fell because of many factors. One of them was that it was sucked dry by Cuba. $50 billion, thanks to the embargo. Naturally, they wanted us to subsidize their client state. Nothing doing, baby. Thanks to mainly Cuban-American legislators who knew how that Castro's operate. They know, we're not going to do it. The Russians were forced, $50 billion, help bankrupt the Soviet Union, save the U.S. taxpayer, and contained Cuban terrorists. But Humberto, it failed. That's a Cold War. I went on John Stossel a year ago, and I said, problem with this debate, embargo debate, it always starts from two false premises. A, that we have an embargo against Cuba, and I explained to you why we don't. We sell, but not on credit. B, that the motivation for that was regime change. And I quote from Secretary of State Dean Rusk explaining when the embargo was put into place that it had nothing to do with regime change. Do any of y'all have any idea why the so-called embargo was put into place in 1961? To read the media, you think, I woke up on the wrong side of the bed one day and said, I'm going to punish those bearded guys. You know, I'm going to slap them out. Folks, Castro stole, his gunmen stole $7 billion from U.S. businessmen at gunpoint. Stole in the summer of 1960. Stole those properties, $7 million. And they murdered and tortured a few Americans who resisted. Howard Anderson was one. He owned a Jeep dealership in Havana. My family knew him. What they did, they were murdering so many people in Cuba by firing squad that so much blood was flowing into the ground that even the commies said, but you know, that's a waste. All that blood just flowing into the earth. We can do it. So what they were doing at the time, and what they did with Howard Anderson, is they would drain most of the blood from the firing squad victims and have just enough for them to kind of hobble over to the and tie them to the stake. Boom, so they'd kill them. And that blood was sold on the international market. After the Vietnam War started, it became very important because Castro was selling, look, he would tell his commie friends in Vietnam, the Yankees are spilling your blood, here's some Yankee blood. And they were selling the blood that they would suck out from U.S. American victims and Cuban victims to North Vietnam. Again, none of this was reported in the media, nothing remotely of the sort. 16,000 men and boys were murdered by firing squad in Cuba. You don't have to be a lunatic right-wing exile. This is featured in the Black Book of Communism. And here's what Che Guevara would do. Because I interviewed people who knew him. And they said, you know, the Castros, you could probably rate as psychopaths. All the murders, all the tortures in Cuba were a means to an end. That end being control. 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 We're going to be all powerful. What it took to do that, it didn't bother them. Che Guevara, they said you could probably classify as a genuine sadist because he seemed to relish in the murder. He had an office above the firing squad field and he had a wall knocked out of it so he could watch the firing squads away and he could watch the victims crumple. And I talked to people who said, when you looked at his face, his eyes would light up, boom, when a volley would hit and the men would crumple. You got the impression that that man was a sadist. He had to be a sadist. Castro didn't care one way or the other. I'm all powerful and so forth. Che was an actual sadist. And before we close out, he was also a coward. The day he was captured, Hollywood tells you he shot his last bullets before he was captured. Bah, bah, bah. Oh, and he had no choice. The second last day of his life, he told his charges, guerrilla charges, "We can't surrender. The revolution stands on your shoulders. You can't defame it by surrendering. So you all fight to the last bullet." He sneaks away from the firefight and goes towards the Bolivian soldiers. So he runs to him. He sees two of them about from here to the clock. And he goes, "I'm Che. Don't shoot. I'm worth to you more alive than dead." While his men were still firing. "I'm Che. Please don't shoot. I'm alive to you more than dead." His men actually escaped. I interviewed some of them because some of them subsequently defected. They made a fighting retreat through Bolivia to Chile, and then from Chile back to Cuba. Now that's worthy of a book and of a movie. They were fighting for a bad cause, but that was that. But why is it that they were able to escape and fight effectively? Because they were finally rid of the doofus sadist Che Guevara. You want to finish? Okay. All right. Good question. Y'all got questions? I'm hard of hearing, but I'll take them.
Hi, my name's Carter from the University of Central Florida.
Okay.
And you don't see a lot of, I don't know, it seems like you don't see a lot of Che shirts recently. Do you think
a lot of what?
Che Guevara shirts lately. Do you think it's kind of dying out?
So glad you brought that up. So glad you brought that up, because I think that these gentlemen back here, Patrick Coyle and Robbins here, has a lot to do with that. When my book came out, it was shortly after the movie The Motorcycle Diaries. It came out in 2008. Che Guevara shirts were all over the place. You see them. And The Motorcycle Diaries got rave reviews. Nowadays, if you go to social media, you go on the internet, whenever somebody says something good about Che, they're all over them. People on social media are all over them, very often quoting the YAF's banner on Che Guevara. I really think it has had an effect. I didn't think it would at the beginning. I thought it was too entrenched to mythology. Also, when Benicio del Toro's movie came out, Benicio del Toro was a production actor. He was Che, but he was also a producer in Steven Soderbergh. When that movie came out, it was nothing like The Motorcycle Diaries. Artistically, it was different, it was good. But people actually jumped on it. Why didn't you show La Cabaña? Why didn't you show? So things have changed, and I'm here to tell you that I think YAF is responsible for that.
Cool, thank you.
Hi, my name is Andrea Vasciano, and I go to Rutgers University. I just wanted to thank you for such a great talk and ask you a question. I know that a lot of Cuban people, I think nearly all Cubans in America are conservative, but the rest of Latin America is like very leftist, or they're not critical of like the leftist dictatorships. So I was wondering, do you see this changing in the future? Like, do you think that other Latin Americans will become like Cubans and realize that like the dictators are bad?
You would think it would. You would think it would. Obviously, Cubans are conservative for a reason. We had to live it. Now, you see some Venezuelans the same way. Venezuela, by the way, is a Cuban colony. It is run by Cubans. The media tells you that there are 50,000 Cuban doctors and teachers in Cuba. Oh, isn't that nice of them? Folks, it's military and police. Venezuela military and police is run, not directed, run by Cubans. So it's a colony. So you've got some Venezuelans here who were very much like Cubans because we lived it. But I don't see it. As a matter of fact, the saddest part of it is that when you see Latin Americans from other nations moving to the U.S., they tend to vote Democrat. They tend to go the other way, which doesn't make any sense. Why are we going over there and then trying to turn the place into the mess we left from? You know? As a matter of fact, and that's especially true now. Boy, I didn't want to get to this, but I'm going to have to, because lately the Cubans that are coming over now are not like my generation. The ones that have been coming over for the last 10 years since Obama, because you see, the Castro regime gives 20,000 visas to Cubans to come to the U.S., but the Obama administration leaves the issuing of those visas to the Cuban authorities. So they give them to people, Cubans who come to the U.S. They sprint off the plane in Miami and run straight to the welfare offices. In Cuba, they give them seminars on how to fill out the forms. And you can qualify for roughly $1,800 a month in welfare, assorted welfare benefits, refugee benefits. That didn't exist when we came, baby. That didn't exist. So what happens? Thanks to Obama's loopholing of Obama, they sprint to the welfare offices and then go home and start getting their welfare benefits, and then they sprint to the Western Union office and start wiring it back to Cuba, to the relatives where the regime gets it. That's where that $5.2 billion that I'm talking about. It is a racket. And those people get on a fast track to citizenship, and from what I've seen, like 90% register Democrat. It is a major scandal. So I wish I could answer your question more optimistically, but no. I'm afraid we're a lost generation. Sorry.
Thank you.
Okay.
Hi, I'm from University of Virginia.
Wonderful.
I really enjoyed your talk there, and I was kind of curious to know like your opinion on Operation Pedro Pan.
Pedro Pan?
Yeah. Like, what do you think about that?
It's famous. More people should know it. I would have had more time. Like I said, there's so many scams to cover. I couldn't touch it. I have good friends that were part of Operation Pedro Pan. Cuban parents just put their kids on planes to leave Cuba. We left right the year before. I came with my dad was a political prisoner. I came with my mom and my brother and sister. Cuban parents, 15,000 Cuban kids, you know, from 10 years old down, were just put on planes. Cuba, when they saw that it was going communist, because the communist regime was going to mainly take their minds. You see, the Cuban Revolution was only 30 years after the Spanish Civil War, where the communists had tried to do the same thing there. And a lot of Cubans had relatives in Spain that said, we're not going to let them brainwash our kids. They're going to the U.S. even though they're going there alone. It's a tragic story. It's worthy of a movie. If anybody else had been victimized like that by a right-wing regime, it'd be all over Hollywood. But since Castro's responsible, we're never going to hear about it.
All right, thanks.
Yeah. Well, that's what helps.
So, I want to thank Humberto for coming today. If you guys want extra copies of our Victims of Che Guevara poster, this is the photo mosaic that Humberto helped us with. These are pictures of people killed by Che and the Cuban regime, and really put that up on your campus. You're welcome to have as many copies as you would like, because we have lots of them. So anyhow, we'll take a short break and we'll be back with our next speaker. Thanks.
All right, buddy. Okay. And around lunch, speaking of the glories of capitalism, I've got some of these books. Lunch for sale. For you, $10. Cheaper than Amazon. Signed copies. This is about the glories of capitalism, right? What could be more appropriate? For you, $10. Later on.